Apple has made it possible to capture video in Dolby Vision with the iPhone 12. In this way, Dolby Vision suddenly became accessible to significantly more users. In this video, I will explain what Dolby Vision stands for, what you should know about it, what it has to do with HDR, and how you, for example, as an iPhone user, can get the most out of Dolby Vision. It seems to me necessary to clarify two things first. I am not a professional colorist and will explain many concepts in this video in a simplified way. So if you want to add something to the explanations in this video, you are of course welcome to do so in the comments. Simply put, Dolby Vision is about improving the image quality of video. It's about better contrast, better colors, and especially a higher dynamic range. This means that Dolby Vision and HDR or high dynamic range are two closely related concepts. But what is high dynamic range? In photography, HDR has been known for a long time. Imagine you want to take a picture of a scene where there are very bright and very dark areas in the same frame. If you expose the shot too bright, there is a risk that the very bright areas in the image will burn out and not show any details. If you expose too dark, a part of the image will only be black. So you take several shots of the same scene with different exposures and overlay the images in post. This way, you keep all the details in the very dark and very bright areas of the photo. This is possible with almost every camera and computer today. However, HDR video differs from this method, also because it would be very difficult to implement for video. To understand HDR video, we should first talk about brightness. When it comes to monitors, smartphones and TV screens, the maximum brightness is measured and indicated in so-called nits. In simple terms, a nit stands for the light that a candle produces within a small cube. The more nits, the more maximum brightness a screen can display. With smartphones, this can be for example an advantage if you want to use your smartphone outdoors in a bright environment. Older televisions can only display approximately up to 100 nits. In this context and with regard to this older standard, one also speaks of SDR or standard dynamic range. However, our eyes can perceive and distinguish levels of brightness that are many times higher. Therefore, this old limit of 100 nits leads to an image that basically looks flat and unrealistic to our eyes. And this is where HDR comes into play. Modern HDR screens can display around 1000 nits of brightness. This does not mean, however, that the image as a whole will be much brighter and will dazzle the viewer as much as if he were looking directly into the sun. A normal sheet of paper or any other matte white object could still be as bright in HDR as on an older screen. Direct light sources, however, such as the sun in the scene, or lamps or reflections, can now be displayed much brighter. This makes the image look much more realistic. Apart from maximum brightness, it is often stated that HDR screens can also display darker blacks. The fact is that the contrast is increased quite considerably, since the difference between the darkest part of the image that is black and the brightest part of the image becomes much bigger. Since the area between black and extremely bright has now become much larger, there are now also much more gradations or shades in between. Even though the concept of HDR video primarily refers to this higher brightness range and contrast, the colors also play an important role when it comes to displaying an image as realistically as possible. The colors that our eyes can see can be represented graphically roughly like this. So this is the color space we can perceive. The standard that was developed for HD television or SDR and is called Rec 709 covers only a small part of this color space of our eyes. It covers only about 36% of this color space. You could represent the colors of Rec 709 as such a triangle. In order to provide a more realistic representation, HDR formats use a much larger color space, the color space BT2020. This color space covers with about 76% a much larger range of the colors we can see naturally. This allows, for example, to display much more saturated colors. Now that our contrast, that is the difference between very bright and very dark, has become bigger and the colors we can display have become more, it would also make sense to be able to display a large number of shades for the different colors. Imagine that you take the color red and could display only 4 shades between very dark and very bright. Transitions between bright and dark could not be displayed seamlessly. Our older screens and the video standard SDR have a color depth of 8-bit. What does this mean? Our RGB color model is based on the 3 color channels red, green and blue. The other colors are generated by a combination of these 3 colors. 8-bit now means that of all 3 color channels, for example red, 256 shades can be displayed. So this goes from a very dark red to a very bright red. This sounds a lot, but from today's point of view, it is not. In certain situations, this is not enough for an even gradation of the colors. If the shades are not sufficient to represent a certain image, strange stripes often appear. This is also called banding. For HDR content, 8-bit is definitely not enough, especially if you consider that HDR achieves much higher levels of brightness, and thus the difference between black and extremely bright has been significantly increased. In this case, you need much more than just 256 shades between a very dark and a very bright red. The next higher standard is 10-bit, that would be 1024 steps per color channel. Again, the next step is 12-bit, which is 4096 shades of color. Simply summarized, 10-bit and 12-bit can be used to display much finer shades of color, which is absolutely necessary to correctly display HDR content. And by the way, for the case you are new here, my name is Werner, I live in the Italian Alps, and on this channel I do filmmaking tutorials and reviews of consumer cameras. Consider subscribing if you are interested in these topics. In the video description, you can find links to all the gear I use to create my videos. So now we have learned a lot about brightness, color space and color depth, and I think you understand that HDR is mainly about display technology. The sensors of the cameras we use to capture our videos do not seem to be the problem. In fact, even our consumer cameras and their sensors have long been able to capture brightness levels and color spaces far beyond the capabilities of a typical HDR screen. You can imagine that today's screens come in a wide variety of models with a wide variety of capabilities. Some of them can't do HDR at all, and even the HDR displays can be very different from each other. The content creator or the colorist who creates his HDR content, so his video, of course cannot take into account the different brightness levels and color spaces of thousands of displays. And this is where the next important HDR component comes into play, metadata. Under metadata, you simply have to imagine additional information about the footage, which is necessary to display the HDR content as good as possible. This metadata is added to the HDR content and it tells the display how to match the content to the limit of its own color space and peak brightness. So without the metadata, the display would not know how to display the HDR content optimally. Let's assume that the HDR content was created for a maximum brightness of 4000 nits, but the display can only display a maximum of 2000 nits, which is a lot anyway. But somehow, the image has to be adapted to the display in an optimal way. And this is only possible with the help of metadata, which provides the necessary information for this. And with the metadata, there is a crucial difference that you should also know. The difference between static and dynamic metadata. With static metadata, the whole content, for example the whole video or the whole movie, is analyzed, and depending on what is the brightest point or pixel of the whole video, or also what is the widest color spectrum that occurs during the course of the video as a whole is then adapted to the possibilities of the display. Of course, this is not ideal, because these maximum values could be attributed to only one short scene, but then the whole content is adjusted and limited. It would be better if every single scene or frame is analyzed, and then the content is dynamically adapted to the limits of the display. This is the only way to get the most out of the HDR content and to display it as good as possible on the display. And this is exactly what happens in the case of dynamic metadata. So dynamic metadata is especially important when there are big differences between the original content and the display. For example, if the content was created for a maximum of 4000 nits, but the display can only display less than 1000 nits. Only with dynamic metadata, this big difference can be adapted as good as possible. I think that with this, we have clarified all the important basic terms regarding HDR, at least in a simplified way. So what does Dolby Vision stand for? As you can imagine, there are different formats or standards for HDR, and Dolby Vision is simply one of them. The most commonly used format of HDR is HDR10. HDR10 uses only static metadata and supports up to 1000 nits of brightness. Then there is HDR10 Plus, which was developed by Samsung. HDR10 Plus is open source and can be used license free. It supports dynamic metadata and up to a maximum of 4000 nits brightness. HDR10 and HDR10 Plus support a color depth of 10-bit. And then there is Dolby Vision. Dolby Vision also uses dynamic metadata. And it is precisely this dynamic adjustment of the footage that is considered a particular strength of Dolby Vision. Dolby Vision supports up to 10,000 nits of brightness and 12-bit color depth. These values are rather theoretical, since there are currently no displays that support these maximum values. On paper, however, Dolby Vision would be the best of these standards and capable of the best possible image quality. Now, where does the iPhone 12 stand, and what should you consider when using HDR and Dolby Vision on the iPhone 12? The iPhone has an HDR display, which according to Apple can display up to 1200 nits brightness in HDR. As explained, this does not mean that the display will produce 1200 nits completely and constantly. Rather, it is about the maximum brightness of the brightest pixel in an image. The same values apply to the iPhone 12 and the iPhone 12 Pro. At the same time, the camera of the iPhone can capture video in Dolby Vision HDR, which is then of course optimally displayed on the iPhone screen. After everything we have discussed and learned in this video, one thing is now obvious. If you shoot Dolby Vision content and don't play it back on your iPhone, but transfer it to your computer and then play it back on a normal monitor or even an older TV, the result may not be optimal and may not look the same as on your iPhone. A monitor or even a TV that is not capable of HDR or Dolby Vision cannot display the content in the same way. As we have seen, such a device cannot display the high maximum brightness levels of HDR. Of course, Apple is aware of these problems. For this reason, the video will be converted to what we call normal or SDR video when you transfer it to another device. This happens immediately and automatically when you transfer the video via AirDrop or send it to friends via WhatsApp. You can see the result here. The image looks similar to a shot with Dolby Vision HDR turned off. It might have a little less contrast because the shadows are a little brighter. You should be aware of this when you shoot a video with your iPhone, are excited about the HDR video quality and then send the video to friends. The video will look normal and still good, but not as spectacular and realistic as on your iPhone. You should definitely consider that. However, for these reasons, you don't need to disable HDR. If you import your videos using the Apple Photos app, however, the footage will not be converted immediately. You can then export the video as an unedited original and it remains an HDR video. However, this HDR video is also adapted directly to your screen and displayed correctly during playback. Creating and editing an HDR project on my older iMac, which does not have an HDR capable screen, is theoretically possible, but probably not very reasonable. Final Cut Pro currently supports HDR, but not Dolby Vision. Dolby Vision support is planned to be added later this year. Now the question arises whether you can use these Dolby Vision HDR videos, exported as described above, in a normal, non-HDR project at all, and whether the HDR recordings might even offer you advantages in dynamic range. Let me show you the workflow in Final Cut Pro. If you import an HDR video into a normal project, your HDR clip will look completely overexposed at first. Using the HDR tools effect, the clip is then converted to Rec. 709. You can add the missing contrast yourself in color grading. Do you get more dynamic range this way, that means more details in the dark and bright areas of the image, than with a non-HDR iPhone clip? Not necessarily, as you can see here. The normal clip already has an incredible dynamic range. In fact, as you could see, the HDR clip leads to a rather cumbersome workflow. If you use an HDR clip that has already been converted by your Mac, the clip will look very similar to the clip taken without HDR. If you make the shadows a bit darker, the shots will look almost identical. While I can't see any major advantages in this case, I can see hardly any disadvantages either. So you can still capture your videos in HDR even if you want to use the clips for a normal project. Maybe one day we will all work with HDR capable hardware and can then take advantage of our old Dolby Vision clips. And that's it for today. If the video was interesting for you, give me a like as feedback. If you want to support the channel, you can use the link in the description and buy me a coffee. See you next time.